Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I hadn't known about this campus and the extent of this campus until I drove out here this afternoon, or early evening, I should say, and found this was a beautiful, beautiful place. You're very lucky. I mean, the environment is absolutely gorgeous, and you have these wonderful sort of pools outside, and you know, I think it really makes the whole environment come alive to have great architecture in terms of your building. This university center I was telling Bridget was fascinating. I just found it, you know, so beautifully designed, the way it moves and the openness that it exhibits. So it's a pleasure to be here, and thank you for inviting me, Bridget. I have got all three of my books here, and I thought what I'd do is that I would read a couple of poems from my earlier collections, a couple from each of the earlier collections, and then go on to No One Waits for the Train. So you'll get a sense of the development that might have taken place, or my evolution as a poet that might have taken place over the years. So the first one that was published was Six Geese from a Tomb at Maidum. And here I would like to explain the title and then go on and read a poem which is titled the same way. Maidum is in Egypt. It's a place where they discovered the cave paintings. And this is, in fact, perhaps one of the oldest examples of paintings that is extant in the world. To me, it is quite remarkable that so many civilizations have come and gone, and there's been so much, you know, murder and killing and war and conflict in the world, yet this art has survived. So for me, that was a potent metaphor for what artists try to do. They are not fighting the battles out there, you know, killing anyone, bombing things, etc. They are really recording things and recording their imaginative ideas and visions and images too, narratives as well. So I will begin by reading a poem that is actually a homage to those artists, to those painters from the past, perhaps whose names also we do not know, but who have left us some outstanding works of art, poetry, literature, music. So this is called Six Geese from a Tomb at Maidum. Five millennia dehiss under their unmoved eyes. Falcons fly into the sun. The serpent hurries past the sarcophagus. And the Red River flowers out of the ram's slit throat. Mother Moon, your ghost travels weary and transparent across skies, and across your face, smoke from offerings burnt at altars amid incense and chants. Violated, thighs smooth as trunks of young trees tremble with awakening. A grasshopper tickles the bull's nostrils. Naked-footed and slim peasant women walk over sand, chiseling the hot-grained air into cool of temples over cool floors, bringing bee stings and fresh fruits swelling in their arms. In the glittering navel of the desert, pyramids of massive stone rise, tapering urgent to the sky's caressing fingers. A valley of tombs and bas-relief provisions. Rock city with its lifeless population. Rock compact and comb, rock serving men, rock wheat, and pale papyri rolls awaiting the coming forth by day. The Nile covers the earth with its desire. Departing drops a gift beside the sleeping desert, a rustling scarf of green. Isis, Isis, sister, wife, mother, goddess of love. Her hips and waist, her glistening breasts, molded of rich black soil, yearning and abundant. Meek in a stable, reeking with spoor of horses and wet straw, she nursed the godchild. Her nipple pubescent, her eyelids bent. Mother of God, dead, dead now. And Osiris, Amon, Horus, all dead. Cheops, Khephren, and Menkaure, Thutmose, Akhenaten, Rameses, colossi of weathered stone, pictographs crumbling in the wind. Ferrymen take the car across. Their souls flit among trees like nightbirds. The Sphinx remains subtle under its broken nose. The six geese painted by an unknown hand pull across the granite air. One of my concerns from very early has been to write about the environment that was around me. And I've responded to the social conditions, political conditions, as much as to the beauties of the place, aesthetic beauties of the place. But somehow, even when I was writing poetry, let us say that related to, or for that matter, fiction or nonfiction that related to describing imaginatively the beauties of a particular object in nature or nature itself or in human beings and their interactions, the political side, the social side of it was not disjunct from it. It was always there. So what I would like to read at this time for you is a poem that relates to, this was written in 1984 and it's called The Wall. And it was something that I noticed at that time in the country that I grew up in, that I was born in, Pakistan, a certain kind of shift that was taking place where suddenly the openness, the liberty that we had before was beginning to be constricted in some way or the other. There were certain extreme positions people were taking. There was certain disregard, lack of communication, and there was a military government. And I've never been a fan of military governments ever. You know, in one of my poems, I call them a crocodile with a civilian belly. You know, so they pretend to be what they are, but you know, they're really something else. So this is called Wall. I had no idea that it might have pertinence or relevance a few years later, or even for that matter today, and in a much wider context. But now when I read it, I see that it may have some pertinence, which I could not at that time have imagined. I had written it very much in response to a local situation, a very local stimulus, as it is. Wall. "Come," she said, "and I will show you the place. A dream is more real. Its landscapes melt into each other. Its faces stay with you. This is all that's left, a rubble of walls without shadow. The charred lintels show there was a fire and black-faced masonry. Only an explosion could have brought down the structures in this manner. I do not know what this burnt brown means, this shade deeper than earth's, running like a vein of rich ore. I do not know. These are the survivors, these thin-legged men and women, these boys and girls with blank eyes. They do not know what happened. They will tell you what they have heard. They know nothing. They remember nothing. Theirs is a memory of walls, of the sound of leaves rasping in the breeze of quiet afternoons. They go about naked and cannot sleep. We have heard the dead drub of drums with wide spaces between each beat. It takes days to pick up the pattern with careful listening, sometimes months. The alarm is caught at once. Metallic shrieks rip the air. Bring down the wall, bring down the wall. Why have you come back? It is as if you have risen from the dead. Not that we have died here while you lived. Do you see this withered stump? It is said that this was a tree damned when it did not bear fruit in season. And many have come to it during the years, and for none did this tree bloom again. You are crazy, I said. You are crazy. Did I not plant this tree with my own hands? Did we not water it together? What are you saying? You are mad. You are mad. This is the wall, they say, where people were lined up daily, week after week, year after year. They were not made to face the wall, but stood with their backs to it. They were not blindfolded. We are not moving over stones, but over something equally unyielding. Look. These are casts whose tissue has melted away, bones that have petrified. It is said that all this was being prepared while we laughed and argued and went about our businesses." You know, this was actually right after I had visited one of the forts, one of the ancient forts in the city of Lahore. It's called the Lahore Fort. And it was with a group of some foreigners as well, and some locals. And the archaeologist, resident archaeologist of the place, wanted to show us, before the entire wing was demolished, the place which had been utilized as prison cells for political prisoners. And it was with a shock and disgust and repulsion that we found that there was crumpled, dry skin on the ground. People had been tortured there. So anyway, I don't want to bore you with the disgusting details. But, you know, there is another kind of life sometimes elsewhere. And people still try to create sense of a life that is as chaotic and as wild and as meaningless as this. Their themes and their ideas when they're writing poetry may be very different or somewhat different than people living in a more secure society, in a society that offers hope and opportunity. Now, moving on to Miriam's Lament. Again, the title here is given. Very interested, by the way, in the female voice. I've always been, have also adopted sometimes in my poems the female voice to articulate a certain range of feelings or responses. It's not because I want to appropriate the female voice here, but I've felt reading histories of the past and reading even scriptures from the past that often the female voice is somehow squelched, and perhaps it could be allowed to come out as it should. So with Miriam's Lament, actually, Miriam referred to here is Moses' sister. And for me, it was quite extraordinary that at one point the Bible describes her as a prophetess in her own right. And then later on, it shows her challenging Moses, first of all, after they have gone to the, escaped from Egypt to the desert of Sinai, challenging Moses, along with Aaron, of course, that he had either married or was having an affair with an Ethiopian woman. And immediately she is the one who was struck by leprosy. God was very angry with her. And then Aaron pleads with Moses and says, what is this? You know, we have been with you, and she's the one who pulled you when you were a child, floating in a basket in that river, in the Nile. She's the one who pulled you out of the river. She is the one who's looked after you all these years and supported you. And look what's happened to her. Is this the dream that you're taking us to? What is going on? And so Moses prays to God, and God says, well, if a father spits on his daughter, would she not be ashamed 7 days? So put her out of the camp for 7 days, and after 7 days, her leprosy would be gone. And indeed, this is what happens. But I've found this to be very strange. You know, and of course, we don't hear much of Miriam after this in the Old Testament. And somehow I imagined her. So I wrote a series of poems about that. I'm only going to read to you the last part, which is conceived as a kind of a whirling, sort of half-disoriented dance that she performs or goes through outside the camp, as it is. She too cannot understand why everything has come to this point. And in a way, it's like reconceiving this. So I'm not asking you to believe this as realistic or anything, but it is my response to a narrative that that leaves for me a lot of questions unanswered. I attended a conference at one time, and this was, I believe, where was it? In Boone, of all the places, very interestingly, in Boone, where there was a person of Jewish origin who was presenting a paper precisely on Miriam and talking about the Midrash tradition in which similar questions had been raised. So it was very interesting to me that, you know, what I had thought of independently reading this was not, again, an isolated thing. You know, we become too arrogant in thinking, oh, you know, this is a unique thought. I'm the only one who has it. Interestingly, you know, there was perhaps 2,000 years of history behind that. That's cultural sort of impress for you, if you would have it. So this is called Dance 2. And it has a little epigraph from the Bible. And the cloud departed from off the tabernacle, and behold, Miriam became leprous, white as snow. And Aaron looked upon Miriam, and behold, she was leprous. Dance to his acceptance, dance to his submission, dance and song, song and dance, living in the nether world, wandering, counting, not loving, wanting to love, hearing each hour the body's cry, strident under the sun, and shattering, demolishing its granary, granary of sun, restoring me my body, grain by guilty grain, generating tissue, muscle, bone, gall of bone fragments, power crumbles, withers, bone battered, old, old the eye, dim the mold, darkness and dance, dance and darkness, timbrels and castanets by the orange flame, outside darkness and space lowing in the night, darkness too is acceptance, darkness is submission, neither quail nor manna terminate my night, imprint of cloud, like sky cracking up, my skin crazed with your spider web, jealousy, sickness, marks from the palm of your hand. Song is darkness, and darkness dance of submission, acceptance and submission. Silt of my body, washed down Nile, my body's loam and clay pierced by bulrushes, struggling to breathe the swamp's bad breath. A brother's slave before he could speak, a mother's handmaid fetching her pails of water, reared to serve each plow that digs my furrow, to rear bulrushes and children, children and sorrow. Sorrow too is acceptance. Sorrow is submission. Darkness and submission. Dance and song. Song in uterus. There I fling them in your face. Refuse to bear, refuse to rear sorrow or children. Cold. Cold is night under desert skies, and too much killing, too swift your terrible reckoning. Tabara, Kibroth, Hatava, Hezeroth. Through Sinai, like fluids from an abscess, a culture of pestilence and Paran wilderness. Wilderness too is submission, and wilderness is yet to come. Wilderness of dance, wilderness of song, wilderness and song. Sorrow and darkness, silver. Trumpets call us to doom, and Hubab muttering his finger in sand, sand our bodies, twist of leather and rope on our flesh, on our bodies like a sickness, Sipora's tongue, a slab of sand powdering with the first unsaid word, a mouthful of sand from Abyssinia, from Abyssinia come slaves and virgin princesses, their skins shiny, flame to touch, long-legged and fleet, heavy their buttocks, their breasts warm, a forest in their eyes. The moon is a heifer calling in the skies. The moon is a crab burning in the night, clattering among stars, afraid and unsteady, stars of lost affection, affections of silence, incomplete and unspoken, affections too are acceptance, affections and submission, affections in wilderness. Heal her, O God, of the imprint on her skin, cracks on her body, terrors enough and guilt of robbed birthright, child and mother in the desert's fiery chill, in her undulating body of burning sand, curving, writhing. If her father had but spit in her face, should she not be ashamed? 7 days, 7 days. Brittle the sun, the moon, white, dry. Tabara, Kibroth, Hatava, Hezeroth. Across the Red Sea, through Sinai, like fluids from an abscess, a culture of pestilence and Paran, Paran wilderness, wilderness too is submission. Envious thou for my sake, envy is acceptance, envy too is submission, song and envy, sorrow and dance. Would God that all the Lord's people were prophets, and that the Lord would put his spirit upon them, imprint of spirit, imprint of cloud, spirit of the Lord. The spirit too is sickness, the spirit too is plague, great the plague, and the flesh yet between their teeth. And he of all men most meek, beware the enmity of the meek, beware the grudge of the humble, the poison of the lowly. God too is acceptance, God too is submission, man and God, God and man. Darkness and envy, envy and song. In the recounting there is truth, in the recounting error, error and truth, truth and error. For the believers and those who do not believe, error and truth, truth and dance, sorrow and error, wilderness and sickness, sickness and truth, truth too is sickness, sickness and song, song and sorrow, sorrow of the spirit too is sickness, sickness and song. wilderness and dance, dance and wilderness. Okay. This was also, this contains poems also that I wrote while I was at Iowa in that International Writers Program. It's a very interesting program where writers from 30, 35 different countries of the world, you know, one writer from each country was there. It's a program that has been going on for a while, it's still there. And we were together for an entire semester looking at each other's works and reading together, giving readings together, panel discussions, traveling across the United States, meeting writers from the United States. I had not yet migrated to the States. By the way, that was the experience I had, which misled me into believing that a writer's life is most glorious, you know. You need to do nothing whatsoever. So when I came as a proper migrant to the United States, I suddenly found I had to work to survive. What was I thinking? Anyway, so there it is. But I will read you one poem from there. It's called Mayflower 1988 or Mayflower 88. Mayflower was the building in which we lived. It's a dorm. And we were given an entire floor to ourselves. This is the International Writers Group. And of course, you know, we all had this sort of kind of pressure on us. I should say it was more a self-imposed pressure than anyone saying that we should do anything. We were just there to share our work, but we should also be writing. We felt guilty for not writing. Anyway, so part of that experience, which is I think is included here. So Mayflower 88, the first part. Clouds swell in massed menace inwards from the sky's shoreline, and rumbling breakers crest suddenly in shattered white. Riding lightly, packed cumulus heaps stacked, floating rain cribs, silos of fresh picked moisture lashed by wind blasts. I walk along streets in shade, wings on my walking shoes, and by the wayside is a window, an eye to the room. A warm petal leaf flows, A warm petal leaf glows in a glass lantern. The chair by the table is haunted by a ghost. A pair of reading glasses lies on an open book. Number two. Halfway across the world, my city's sod gives off the burnt wet smell of damp munch grass. Monsoons are at hand. What primal fragrance stirs in the earth's interstices? In dark crevices which emit estuous must. Here too, before rain, transient in the smell of fresh baked bread, the warm petal leaf of your body burns in a steady flame. Not here, but in some cobbled street behind houses clicks a staff. Beads fall in a clatter. This road hears the sounds. Roosting birds rise abruptly, hang in air, feet stretch downwards as they balance above black boughs, then subside in foliage. Three. Flesh is elusive, inconstant as silver. Your body has the thwack of gold, a fingerprint dug in your ankle. Turmeric light aslant a slim minaret. Daily on the mosque's upturned breasts, the sun drains its cask of wine. Between us, an unbroken syntax of desire and abstinence establishes distance and nearness. You differentiate into leaves. Outside, the flicker of silk caressed by anxious hands. The bargaining, telling of jokes, walking about in a dream of wares. Last night, the moon descended into the clear pool yonder. Not a ripple, not a sound disturbed its surface. The city slept, and cities within slept, and leaves of darkness grew thickly about them. But a bird watched with tilted head and sang. Number four. My shoes knock against asphalt in the night on a clean black street margined by gray pavements. There are no birds in maple, sycamore, or oak, but fat squirrels sit up and crack nuts by the grass fringe. The slow throb of traffic lights regulates the city's pulse, and a river flows by without a sound. Through glass doors, I enter a beehive of living quarters, press the elevator button. The eighth floor is a corridor of cells. Writers are all condemned to write. The doors are shut. The typewriter's keys struggle to find the shape of the muse. Okay. So from there onwards, you know, I actually moved to the United States. Have I run out of time? I could just read one or two from here, you know, short ones. I don't have short ones, but I should. It's terrible. I should consciously write short poems, because when I start looking for it, you know, I don't find short poems. Anyway, so this is the thing that was burdening my mind. It seems that in Pakistan, as in India, the 1947 event of the division of the subcontinent, the Indo-Pakistan subcontinent, looms very large on our imagination. Why did we do it? What happened? A million people, by the way, were killed, literally slaughtered at the time of partition within a period of, what, 3 months? And about 6 million people were displaced from one side to the other. See, today we were all living in one country and then a line is drawn. Whoever demands it or whatever the nature of the demands or whether it is the divide and rule, however you want to look at it, policy of the empire. But once the line is drawn, these two sides are enemies of each other. One is Muslim and the other is everyone else, which means Sikhs and Hindus and so on. So the Hindus living and the Sikhs living in the Muslim area are hounded out of that place, killed and slaughtered, robbed, looted, their houses set to fire. And the same fate is meted out to the Muslims living in India. And so that was indeed a terrible period. And a lot of us in Pakistan and in India somewhat also feel that what we see in terms of the chaos today, mostly in Pakistan today, but also in India, India is not free of it either, is because of, you know, that the memory of that violent time. There is no justification for it. I don't know why it should have happened or why it happened. Could human beings who are normal like everyone else, who have families, who have father, mother, wife, kids, could they perpetrate such crimes? But, you know, that is what they did. For me, it is a little complicated because my family comes from Kashmir, and the Kashmiri part is the disputed part between India and Pakistan. Nobody talks about, what about the Kashmiris themselves? You know, do they want to join in with any one of them or not? It's just decided that either India or Pakistan should have Kashmir, or if they are in dispute, let's just draw a line, which is what we have, the international border. Half of Kashmir is in India and half of it is in Pakistan. It's a strange situation. So I thought I'd confront this situation. And in this book, I describe in graphic detail, by the way, some of the acts, horrendous acts of slaughter that occur. And I do that not because I like doing this, I like these dark thoughts or dark actions. I do that because often we forget that this too is the domain of poetry. At the final, you know, in the final analysis, we have to confront the reality as it is and say, this is what we were capable of doing, unfortunately. We should not repeat this, you know. So maybe once we see it, once we feel somehow moved by it, we would not repeat it. But I'm going to try and avoid to read the darker poems here, but I'll give you one that is more like a recall of this character's childhood in Kashmir. It's called Beyond the Wooded Slope. Beyond the wooded slope where deodar and pine stand towering against the sky and the chinar offers its stained hands, there across the heart's ridged spur, sunlight suddenly rams into your eyes like a train of gold. There I meet you again in the old places, in that fertile patch of memory where you and I rush wildly down hills and leap over brooks that spring out of nowhere and foam heedlessly away. And the forest closes around us as we venture to explore its dark, backward spaces, where birds titter and chuckle and fear and mystery, wraith-like in the glooming, stretch out their hands and beckon to us. Walnuts are still green and almond trees are laden with pink and white blossoms. Raspberries grow wild everywhere and pools of blue, purple and white irises are in bloom. And little by little, we too are breaking out in love, perhaps. That was before we moved to Amritsar, in search of better prospects, our saffron and rice not bringing in enough, and our orchards of pear and apricot costly and difficult to maintain. Mulberry was delicious and abundant, but too common to sell well. In those days, we had both started school in Srinagar. We left as dawn broke over the hills and came back just before sunset. The family took their spinach and rice together and afterwards sat around the wheel, weaving and chatting into the night. Barima took us to the village sometimes, a short walk from where we lived, and spoke of the privations of common folk. There they moved about on the fringe in tattered shawls, children running barefoot in the alleys, and desolate cottages stood like warts in an embarrassing paradise. And on the way back through the hills, she recounted for us the horrors of Hari Parbat, a prison fortress on a dome-shaped hill, from whose dungeons and cells few returned to tell their tale. But every night she regaled us too with the folk tales and stories from the past, of depraved kings and queens, of goat herds raised to the throne, of fairies and devas that inhabited the mountains, of holy men and brave women who defied the tyrants of their times. It was another age, another time. How quickly it has vanished. In some dream I can see still the two brothers, your father and mine, and their families, mother presiding, Munni just under 7 leaning into her, and Barima all huddled over their work. But you and I sit outside among irises and make up nonsense rhymes, mixing words picked up at school with homespun Kashmiri, and laugh, Barima says, like starlight in trees. You, a princess, whose words become pearls on her lips. That spell is shattered, the loved ones all dispersed, some dead and gone, swallowed up forever by spreading darkness. And Munni, who knows where, caught in the brambles of a strange night. And all of you live under another flag while the land turns in strife. And over our ancestors' dry bones, we continue to wage war. I remember all this as I sit here, my spirit clothed in a drab long robe, the pharaoh that once an invading emperor decreed for all the men of the valley, to extinguish all sense of manhood in them, to make them think and act like women. This would be my dress of choice today. Well, thank you. I will stop here. Thank you very much. I will take questions.
Questions?
Yes.
Can you repeat your name again?
The name is Waqas Khwaja.
One more time.
It's Waqas, Waqas, and Khwaja. Yeah.
When you start writing it, how do you inspire it to start?
It's very odd. I went to a missionary Catholic school where Irish brothers taught. And I think I was in fifth grade when our Irish brother teacher, whose name was Brother Mohani, asked us to write a poem. And I had just read some poetry at that time in class, and the poem that I had been greatly moved by, surprisingly, was Daffodils by Wordsworth. And I wrote one in imitation of that poem. Surprisingly, it was successful. I mean, it was kind of a parody. I kind of recall the last two lines. Suddenly the boat turned into the water, and I was trying to rhyme desperately, and out in its place came an otter. And my father looked at it and he said, "Out in its place came an otter. What is this?" Oh, wow, this is what I came up with. He said, "I think it should be a smiling otter." I suddenly felt that, you know, that line made sense. Anyway, so that's when I wrote, and I think I just got hooked into this because I thought suddenly that there is so much richness to language. It can do so much to your imagination. I was suddenly transported to another world. So that was, you know, my experience. And later on, I became inspired with sports personalities. For instance, there was a cricket batsman, and a lot of you don't even know what cricket is, probably. But it's a strange game that the British have invented and then, you know, handed over to the colonies, and the colonies play it better than them now. Australia is the champion, so you can imagine, and so on. The West Indies were champions for a long time, and so on. India is very good. And so there was a player called Hanif Muhammad who was a very good batsman. And I was, I think, in ninth grade at that time. So I wrote a poem on him, describing and praising him. One of my cousins took the poem, went up to this great batsman and said, he held a couple of world records at the time, and said, you know, I've written this poem, would you please sign it for me? And he signed it. And my cousin said, this is my poem. You are never going to claim, this is the first time since that, you know, decades ago that I've now for the first time claimed it was my poem. But I take it back. I'll say it is still his poem. So that's the origin of it all. Yes.
I had actually earlier today asked Dr. Bird this question, and I'd like to ask you, what is it about, for you, the form of poetry that you feel for you works best to get your point across or to create what you're trying to create?
I think that's an excellent question, and I don't think I will have an authoritative or final answer to that, but I'll attempt to give you a kind of a response, because as a poet, I certainly think about that quite a bit, and sometimes I think in retrospect about what I might or should have done as opposed to while I'm writing, but it could be either way. So though I've practiced and written a lot of stuff in the traditional forms of poetry, including some, I have 120 odd sonnets somewhere, you know, and I hope nobody finds them, but anyway, these were all written between, you won't believe it, 1970 and 73. This is like, it was another era, another millennium. It was, literally. I wrote in various kinds of genres, various forms, etc. But as I wrote, I felt that sometimes, you know, it is the theme, it is the topic itself, it is what moves you, it is the image that may determine the form of the poem itself. And though it was difficult initially to move away from the more constraining forms or the more traditional forms, I finally got to move away from them. And part of the reason was that I became better acquainted with the tradition of English and American poetry, and to read poets who had done such remarkable work in sort of revising and in fact debunking even the old traditional forms, totally creating new kinds of rhythms. I'm talking of Gerard Manley Hopkins, for instance, totally different kind of a voice that you hear in his poetry. Then, of course, William Carlos Williams or T.S. Eliot or E.E. Cummings, and all different kinds of poets, and Gwendolyn Brooks, you know, you name it, and they are remarkable people there. Also Walt Whitman. But then I started hearing voices that I had not heard before a little more consciously. The voices of oral tradition within Punjabi and Urdu poetry. These are the native languages or native traditions of Pakistan. And they were doing some very interesting things as well. So what I have tried to do actually is to like hybridize these forms, to use both forms in a way that you might not immediately on the face of it or on the surface see them, but they are really intertwined here. Bring a narrative form back into poetry. You would see a lot of poetry that is modern poetry that is written today has moved away from narrative. And I'm not saying that's bad at all. I mean, that's fascinating poetry in its own way. But I thought, you know, why not revive that? Because there was a reason for that tradition as well. And maybe we could go back to some of the narrative traditions and bring them into the 21st century and see how that would work. So there are then now a whole variety of things that interest me. But I think thematically, sometimes the form is determined because you say, all right, this is a poem about an experience peculiar to the people living, let's say, in the subcontinent. It would be odd if I were to fashion that experience in a sonnet. You know, it'll be out of place. So I think that disjunct I begin to see a little more clearly now. On the other hand, there are some experiences that work very well in the sonnet form, or a for that matter, in some of the other forms that, you know, that have been developed over the years in the Western tradition. Okay. Any other question? Any other?
When you're writing your longer poems, how do you stay focused so that you don't stray from what you're writing, especially the one you were talking about, the 60s, with a lot of the Egyptian imagery? I was just curious, how do you keep focused so that way you don't stray out there?
Well, and again, an interesting point. I have admired, actually, writers also who do this. And I think some of the best writers that I think are really amazing writers actually do this very well. I came across a short story writer, for instance, who just wrote three-page long short stories. They shouldn't even be called long. I mean, they are short stories kind of thing. And if he were writing, let's say, about, we have somebody who just sweeps the floors, you know, a woman who sweeps the floor, every image in the poetry, in that story would be taken from the experience of that woman. There would be nothing else that would be drawn from outside. And to me, that was very evocative. You know, it's quite remarkable. So I think, to begin with, you may want to do it consciously. This is probably how I did it consciously at one time. But over a period of time, once you do, it becomes an automatic second nature. You're writing about a particular theme and environment, etc. Then your pool of images and illusions is also from that area. So this last book, actually, that I did, No One Waits for the Train, it is about this displaced person, as you would have also heard in the poem that I read, that he has experience of Kashmiri, you know, he went to an English medium school, he goes to Srinagar for that school, and so on. So you see a mixture of that kind of thing there, something that would be peculiarly, you know, Kashmiri, in other words, related to that place, that region, as opposed to the Punjab, where also you would have English medium schools, but the Punjabi tradition would be very different from the kind of features that you see in this poem. So I think it becomes, once you get immersed in it, once you are beyond the whole process of just practicing, you feel more comfortable, it becomes more natural to be able to get into the psyche of such a character and begin to have your images, or the theme for that matter, have your images all revolve around that. That poem about Egypt, for instance, has everything related, even to the grasshoppers and etc. I mean, they are peculiarly related to the gods and goddesses and their mythology. It's not, it's not part of, it is not drawn from any other tradition. So that's pretty much what it is. But thank you for noting that.
You ever get, I'm kind of adding on to Tim's question here a little bit, with the form of poetry, do you ever get tired of or frustrated with the whole form of poetry and try your hand into like other kinds of creative expression, like visual arts or like short stories, or like you're saying? Like
I've done short stories and I've done other kinds of writing, kind of travel narratives as well. The Writers and Landscapes, which is really about the Iowa experience, is more in that nature. It also has a few poems in it, but you know, it's lots of stories and it's a different kind of a form. It wouldn't fit any sort of regular genre, because it has stories there, it has kind of lyrical passages, descriptions, it has literary evaluations or analysis there as well, it has poems there as well, and so on, political commentary, you name it. So it's kind of that, but it's not a hodgepodge in the sense that it's not just all jumbled together. There is something going on there that is trying to, you know, get at the heart of the experience that one might have had in such a program. Does that get to your question?
Like, so is it, what brings you back to the poetic kind of, it's not just narrative kind of prose, but just?
I think the concentration, the intensity, because if I were to write, let's say, what I've written, even in these long poems, I understand these are long poems. My critics always remind me too that you write long poems. All right, but I do. There are shorter ones. I should probably read a very short one and say this is a short one, but just to show that there are shorter ones. But I think it's the intensity. It is what you are trying to convey through that. If you were writing a short story, you still have a little bit more space to develop things. Here, it is also elusive that it is up to the reader to register the emotion and to register the whole context, historical and cultural behind it as well. It may not fully convey, but even if it conveys a part of it, I think it's far more successful because it seems the reader is then imaginatively engaged as opposed to kind of logically, reasonably sort of engaged in it. So, okay. Okay. Right. Yes?
Some writers and poets engage in the writing process when they go through a particular crisis, whether political, religious, romantic, physical. How do you engage in this writing process? I mean, when do you feel that you have that inspiration?
I think it's a great question. And first of all, I'll give you a little historical detail. The place that I was born in and where I grew up, where I had my education, very interesting place. I love the place. I know it is in a state of total chaos today, unfortunately. But it's lovely people, very loving, very affectionate people. And not just my friends and my family, believe me. I mean, it's largely wonderful people, but they are in the throes of a crisis today. You mentioned crisis. When I went to the college from my high school, in my political science class, we had to read a book by William Rushbrook. And you might want to check this on the computer, by the way, on the web, internet, you'd find it. It was called From Crisis to Crisis. Pakistan, unfortunately, ever since its birth, has gone, I partly laugh at it, but it's tragic, from crisis to crisis. So no dearth of crisis for people writing within Pakistan, let me say that. I mean, we all have a lot going on in our private lives, our loves, losses, etc., you know, all those things, being extremely enthused by things, being totally disgusted with things, all kinds of things happen. But nationally and socially, there has always been much going on in Pakistan, I think partly because it has, I will use the word crisis again, a crisis of identity. Mm-hmm. You know, once it separated from India, it did not really know what it was. Is it a Muslim country? Is it a secular country? Is it associated with the Middle East? Is it associated with Central Asia? Is it still a part of India? We have shared history with India. I mean, we do have shared history with Central Asia as well, but I mean, there's 2,000 years plus 5,000 years, I should say, of history from India, from the Indus Valley civilization. You have the sites there in Pakistan, right there. So, partly that is, deep down, that is the motivating factor. I would write, and I do sometimes write about very personal things as well. But I think for me, the personal in this regard really is how I relate to this entity that was my country. That was the place where I was born. And I still think it's quite remarkable because what we have inherited from that country, however one may look at it, oh, you know, this was empire or this was all waves of invaders who came in. But you look at it, the Indus Valley civilization, 5,000 to 7,000 years old, you know, one of the most remarkable civilizations of the ancient world, the Buddhist civilization, the Hindu civilization, the Greek civilization. Alexander, you know, came into this very area. Strangely enough, it was the area that is today Pakistan that he conquered, called it India, Sindhia, S-C-I-N-D-A. And today that is called Pakistan, and the rest of the subcontinent is called India. Interesting detail, but there, Alexander was there. Then the Huns were there, the Mongols were there, the Mughals were there, the Turks were there, and then the British were there. So if you look at it from one point of view, it's one tragedy after other. You can, you know, wail and mourn and say. But on the other hand, it is quite remarkable that the capaciousness of this experience and the variety that this offers culturally in terms of you know, art, literature, possibility of human development, it's immense. We are in a way connected, it seems, to all kinds of, and I didn't mention Africa, by the way. There were a lot of Africans present in India as well during the time of the Muslim rule in India, some of them governors of provinces as well. So it's quite remarkable that we are so interestingly connected to to the rest of the world. And this is part of our psyche, of, let's say, our unconscious. Unfortunately, there are groups, whether they are Hindu or Muslim or Sikhs, etc., who want to believe that history only started on a certain date when their religion started, you know, or when politically this event happened. But this is all part of what we are. So this is what I think motivates me. So, sorry to take so long to describe it. And that, you know, one of the ways to find out who's speaking is that if you're getting bored, you know it is a professor speaking. So. Okay.
No more questions. Well, just let's thank Waqas Khwaja again for
thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you very much.